name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. While we must admire the piety of the multitude that spent 3 days by the Sea of Galilee, so intent on the words of Christ that they neglected the ones to attend the ones of the body. But we must admire still more the providential care of our Lord, who exhorts us to seek first the kingdom of God and His justice, and all things else will be added unto us. And who in this occasion miraculously fed 4,000 men with just a few loaves of bread, a few fishes. I do not know of any truth of revelation more consoling to the human heart than the doctrine of God's special providence over us. How comforting it is, the reflection, that you are not a wave aimlessly drifting down the stream of life, but that you, that your little bark is unceasingly under the guidance of the divine pilot, that amid the storms and tempests which rage around you, there is a voice nearby that commands the winds and the waves. How cheering is the consideration that no matter how dark and lowering the clouds of sorrow that envelop you, the eternal Son of Justice, in His own good time and in the moment most suitable to your needs, will dispel those clouds and will enlighten you after you have sat in darkness and in the shadow of death, as Sacred Scripture says. So it is delightful, the assurance that no injury can possibly befall you against the will of Him whom no power can resist, that God will make the very malice of your enemies to serve as instruments to exalt and glorify you, and that your momentary sufferings will be so many stepping stones to your final victory. That is why St. Paul says, all things work for the good of those who love God. And in order to be assured of God's providential protection, the only condition required is that we do not rebel against His holy will, but heartily abandon yourself to His good pleasure and faithfully observe His commandments. How can we doubt this special providence when we think that He has made us in His own image and likeness, that He has given us an immortal soul, that He has given us God-like faculties of intelligence and will, and that He has appointed us the lords of His earthly domain, and that man is the only earthly being who is made partaker of these sublime gifts. What is even more, He has created us for a definite purpose, for a definite end. His wisdom and mercy required that He should perfect the work He has begun in each one of you, by leading you onward to your destination, by that providential guidance. So He cannot, can we then expect or imagine that God gave you, who gave you your life, does not have the intention of making provision for sustaining it, or that He endowed you with an immortal soul without supplying you with the graces required to reach your eternal destiny? So he cannot be ignorant of our needs, since our whole life is laid bare before him. He cannot be subjected to suspected of inability to provide for us, since nothing is impossible to him. He cannot be charged with indifference towards us, since he is essentially good and gracious. A God of infinite knowledge, he is acquainted with all our wants. God of omnipotent power, he is abundantly able to supply them. You remember Joseph from the Old Testament, how he was cruelly treated by his own brothers, who, after threatening to kill him, cast him into a pit without water, and after that they sold him for a few pieces of silver. Then he was carried into Egypt and bought as a slave, and on a false charge was thrown in a dungeon where he languished for more than 2 years. Joseph brushes aside the visible edges of that long train of sufferings and discerns in them the controlling hand of God Almighty. And so he tells his brothers, "Well, it was not by your counsel that I was sent here, but by the will of God, who has made me, as it were, the father of Pharaoh and the Lord of his entire house. I can even appeal to you, to your own experience. You could take the time to review your past lives. You might be able to see all the entire chain of incidents in the light of faith, and you will have to admit that those vicissitudes of health and sickness, those alternations of joy and sorrow, of prosperity and adversity, all of them were but handmaids of providence, the frowns and caresses of a loving father leading you on to your destination. So it is with your own experience that you have to say that everything works for the good of those who love God. So blessed you might be if you live in an abiding consciousness of an overruling providence. You will never feel lonely because you will never be alone. So the world is not an enigma to you as it is to the rest of humanity. You know that everything happens, from the fall of an empire to the flight of a bird. Everything that happens is controlled by the governor, by the moral governor of the world. And so, with the royal prophet, we could easily say and exclaim, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall want nothing. He has set me in a place of pasture. He has brought me out on the water of refreshment. He has led me on the path of justice for the sake of his name. Even if I should walk in the middle of the shadow of death,